As a software quality engineer on the Lightroom team, there's one thing that I do more often than anything else, and that is to reset my Lightroom preferences. Like, no joke, I think I reset my preferences at least 10 times every day. And after I do it, I pretty much go through the same motions to reconfigure my preferences and the UI to suit my needs. And that's what inspired me to create this video. I want to share some of the most important settings and configurations that I think all new users to Lightroom should consider. But the stuff that I show here isn't only for new users. In fact, I think that there'll be plenty here for seasoned users to learn as well. I mean, I learn new things about Lightroom all the time, and I've been using it since day one. Now, before we begin, I want to point out two quick things. First, this video covers Lightroom Desktop, not Lightroom Classic or the other cloud eco surfaces, but leave a comment if that's something that you'd be interested in seeing, and I might create a similar video for that. Second, there's no particular order to what I'm going to show you here. It just kind of sort of follows the way that I approach a fresh install of Lightroom, so don't worry about having to follow every single thing that I show in a specific order. All right, let's dive in. All right, so here we are. This is my Lightroom library. Again, this is Lightroom Desktop on the Mac. Everything I show you here will work the same if you're using Lightroom Desktop on Windows as well, except some of the keyboard shortcuts obviously might be a little bit different, and I'll do my best to kind of call out, you know, like Alt and Option and Command and Control, those kinds of things. But the purpose of this video is to kind of walk both new and experienced Lightroom users through the things I think are worth kind of like changing or customizing on a new install. So again, I'm already customized here. This is my Lightroom install, and you can see I've got my entire library here. And so if you were a new user, obviously you would have a kind of a big fat zero over here. You know, you wouldn't have any photos if you've never synced photos to Lightroom. You might use the local mode here to view your photos and edit them on an internal or external drive. That's totally fine. But if you're syncing your photos to the cloud, which I honestly think is the best experience for the Lightroom Cloud Eco, but if you are using Lightroom in the cloud and you haven't synced anything yet, this will be a zero. So really quickly, I just want to show you, I've covered this in previous videos, but the way that I organize my photos is I have this kind of top level photo library folder. And under that, I have a folder for each year. And under each year, I have folders for each month, and then under each month, I have the actual albums. And so again, if you are a new Lightroom user, folders can be used to kind of create hierarchy. So like if you want to create a folder and then a subfolder and another subfolder, you can. But then at the very bottom, there's always going to be an album, because photos can only be stored in albums with Lightroom Desktop. Here you could see I have photos in each of these albums. I cannot put photos in a folder. And so that's kind of what I do in terms of how I organize my photos, but that's not the point of this video. I just wanted to show that to you really quickly, because if you are a new user, you might get confused, like you have all these folders and albums and stuff and I don't have anything. That's just because that's how I've set it. So with that, let's go ahead and walk through what will put you in a state of a new user. But there is one thing that I recommend checking before you do that, before you reset your preferences. If you go into preferences here, and then you go to cache, you can see there's this option here called store a copy of all originals. And I have it set to one of my external drives called Bokeh. So basically what happens is when you enable this, Lightroom will keep a copy of the original files and just the original files. It will not keep a copy of your edits. This is more of, I would say, a performance optimization tool rather than a backup tool, because instead of Lightroom having to go to the cloud to download an original if it needs it, it'll just go here first, and so it speeds things up. And so the reason why I want to bring you here is because if you do have this enabled, obviously that means you are an existing Lightroom user, you're not a new user, but just remember this area here. You know, you can take a screenshot of this if you want, because this will be the very first thing that I customize when I reset my preferences. So I'm going to go ahead here, I'm going to cancel, and then I'm going to quit out of Lightroom just because in order to reset your preferences, you have to quit. And so to reset your preferences, it's the same thing on Mac and Windows, except a minor variation to the keyboard shortcut. So you'll go to your Lightroom app, and then on Mac, you're going to press and hold Option and Shift while clicking on Lightroom. And then on Windows, it would be Alt and Shift. All right, so let's go ahead and click on Reset Preferences. What will happen is Lightroom will load. All of the photos that you have already imported will be here. You'll see them on the left here. And usually the very first thing that will pop up will be the what's new dialog, which here you go. It's showing what's new from April 2025 when we introduced the awesome new select landscape masking tools. I'll leave a card right up above if you want to learn more about that. So let's go ahead. I'm going to close out of here. And we're going to start introducing you to the user interface. That's just kind of the first thing we do. You can see that the first thing we want to get you to do is switch to detail view. So you can click here. And now that that's done, if you have multiple monitors, we're going to show you this little floating window here that reminds you that you can open this up in a secondary window. I've got a video that walks you through that, which I'll put a card up right here for that. I'm going to dismiss that. But the first thing I want to show you, again, you can see all of my photos are here. All of the folders are here. We're all good, even though I reset my preferences. But of course, again, if you're a new user, you would have nothing here. So you would just start importing your photos. But to begin, what I want to do is I'm going to go to preferences. And then the first thing I want to do is go to cache, because I want to verify here that these two options that I had enabled, they're still enabled. The store copy of all originals is pointing to Bokeh, which is that external drive. So we're good here. There's nothing that I need to do here, which is fine. But I'm going to work down these tabs in preferences and walk you through some of the things that I prefer to change. We'll start with general. I keep people view activated because I use it all the time. I love it. And then I also like to have this option enabled, which will prevent my computer from going to sleep while it's connected to power when I'm importing and syncing. Speaking of import, let's go here to import. Now, I like having my copyright applied as I import images. So all you need to do is click that checkbox and you can see there is my copyright. Totally fine with this, keeping it simple. Now, I also love editing in HDR. So I'm going to enable this so that HDR is enabled for all new imported photos. And what I mean by HDR is not the kind of photo merge tone mapping where you take multiple images and combine them. I'm talking about actual like 32-bit HDR editing. You need an HDR capable display, but trust me, it is like, it redefines how I edit my photos these days. And so the last thing is whether you want to set, you know, a certain raw default. So you can either have the Adobe default, which is generally what I recommend and use. You can, of course, also use your camera settings, or you can apply any preset that you've imported or that comes with Lightroom to apply to your raw files. Then let's go to export. So for export, this is where you can set your content credentials. And I'm a big fan of this because, especially as AI tools are becoming more and more prevalent, I like the transparency that content authenticity allows. And so what basically this is, think of it as like, you know, when you buy some food, at least in the US, there's always like a nutrition label. It tells you, you know, how much fat and protein and the carbohydrates and calories, and also the ingredients. This is the same thing, the content credentials, where when you export a JPEG, because currently it supports JPEG only, it'll apply things like your name, your social media handles, and your edit history, which is the most important part, including if any AI tools were used as part of your editing workflow for that image. So you have first this option here of how you want to associate the content credentials. You can either just publish it to the content credentials cloud. You can attach it to a file. I use this, which is the combination of the two. And then I also turn these on. You can configure your name and the connected accounts through this little manager link over there. And then I also turn this on. What this checkbox does is if you go to the share button up here and you select one of the JPEG presets that we have, if you select that checkbox, then it'll automatically apply the content credentials to the file. It's just one less thing you need to do. And so moving on to the interface. So there are a few things here that I change as well. First, I'm kind of a recent convert to this for panel tracks. I set that to automatic. And actually, I'm going to share a link to a video at the end of this video that will go through that a little bit more, as well as a few other things that I think will help make this make more sense. But I like to have this set to automatic. The other thing that I disable is swipe between images using mouse or trackpad. I use a trackpad, and so sometimes I inadvertently do like a two-finger scroll, which causes a bunch of photos to scroll by, even if I'm in the middle of an editing session. So I just turn that off. Now, I keep these other options off. Of course, if you need accessibility mode, you should use that. And then depending on whether you are a new user or an existing user, you might turn these options off or keep them on. And basically what these are is if I click done, for example, and I go to edit. First, you'll see that we're kind of guiding you through the user interface. So I'm going to go ahead and click guide. This is part of what I'm talking about. If you don't want to see these things, or if you hover over a tool, for example, you see these rich tool tips. These are very, very helpful for both new and experienced users, just to remind you or to explain to you what each of these tools does. But if you're just like for me, I turn these off because as I'm editing or as I'm doing one of these tutorials, it can be distracting for the viewer to see these pop up. So I turn these off. And so I'll go back to preferences and I'm going to turn both of these off. But again, if you're new to Lightroom, please keep these on. Or if you're existing and you kind of want a refresher, don't just turn these on. Click this reset button over here and also click this reset all warnings dialogs. That will basically really put you to a new user experience. And then finally, under performance, there's really not much to do here. I just recommend keeping this auto unless you are advised by one of the Adobe customer support people or one of the community experts to try to change that setting. I just keep the GPU setting to auto. And so that's the preferences here. I'm gonna go ahead and click on done. Now we can just kind of wrap things up with some kind of user interface tweaks. First, I wanna show you that kind of automatic panel tracking. You see how we're in edit over here. And then if I press P to open up the photo browser, you see how the edit panel collapses and then photo opens. If I just press E and then P, you can kind of see that. That's what auto panel tracking does. If you have that off, then if I were to press E, both the edit panel and the photos panel would be displayed. And so since we're in the edit panel, there are two things I recommend doing right away. First two things. Both of them are over here under the try dot on this right toolbar. The first, without a doubt, show histogram. To be honest, I am not a fan of us hiding this by default. This should be visible for all users. And if you don't know how a histogram works, there's plenty of content to help you with that. Or if you want a video from me on how it works, please let me know in the comments below. And then going right back, the other thing that I recommend enabling is show color calibration. Now, with this here, this is also a debate. I'm just going to show you what I do. First, I go through this and I expand every single sub panel in the entire edit panel here. So you can see I'm going through, I'm also expanding these other sub panels within the tools here. So I just kind of go through here. This is looking good. Then I open up effects, open up vignette, open up grain, and I just go down the list, open up sharpening. The only thing that I do not open is manual noise reduction because I don't use it. I prefer using the AI denoise, then going over here to optics, and then finally to lens blur. And so there we go. We're basically at a full edit panel. And the reason why I do this is because I've been using Lightroom for so long. I just know like how far down to scroll, and I'm just used to this workflow. Other people prefer using this option called single panel mode. Again, in that video that I referenced that I'll link to at the end of this one, I'll walk you through that. Now, I'm a big fan of maximizing screen real estate, like having the image take up as much of the screen as possible. So that means that I also hide the film strip. It's just not something that I ever really used, so I like to hide it. And let's go back to grid. So when you reset your preferences, you'll be put into this photo grid mode. Some people call it a mosaic grid. I like this just because it presents your photos a little bit larger. But for me, I actually prefer the square grid, which is right here. It's the second icon, because it shows me more information. Yes, the thumbnails are smaller, but it shows me the file name, the file format, whether I've applied a flag or stars, and also if the image is edited, whether I've already edited the image, and if the image is downloaded locally. So this gives me a lot of helpful information. The other thing that I do though, is I make the size of the thumbnails in grid larger, and I usually do about 2 or 3 stops before the max. Like some people like to have it super large, and that's fine. I just generally like to do right around there. Also, I almost always work in full screen mode. That's also one of the first things I usually do, so that's good there. And so overall, you can see when I go to edit here, I've got my panel fully expanded, just the way I like it. As I go through with crop, I always expand geometry and the transform subpanel. I use these all the time, so I like to just have them here. With remove, there's not much to do here. I'll go ahead and dismiss these little tooltips. But there is one more thing that I do, and that is if I go to masking, let's go ahead and apply a mask, and you'll see that the default position of the masking panel is kind of floating up here. I don't like that. I don't want anything floating in the active preview area. So I take this panel here and I just dock it over here into the right mask panel. And so here's where it'll stay. The other thing that I do similar to the edit panel is I expand everything, even in masking. I like to just have everything open just so that I have them here. So this is looking good. And again, if I delete the masks and I go say to another image and I go back to masking and I create a sky mask, you'll see that the panel is still docked over here and all of my edit panels here are expanded. And then the last thing I do with masking is customize the overlay, because it's hard for me. I'm red, green, colorblind, so it's sometimes hard for me to see the default overlay. So if I click here, you can see we have this color picker. And generally what I do is I put it around yellow or green and I increase the opacity. And that just makes it easier. Sometimes I will change this color depending, like here you can see it kind of blends with the foreground. So I might change it to blue and that makes it easier as well. But generally I have it right around here with a really kind of thick opacity. That's the other thing that I customize. And I just wanted to show that to you as well. So I hope, again, especially if you're a new Lightroom user, I hope this gives you a bit more confidence and comfort in what are the things that you should consider doing to customize the look and feel of Lightroom for you. Now, of course, you can take or leave everything I show you. You can stick with the defaults by all means. But after using Lightroom for so long, I've kind of found a good equilibrium of what I like and what I tend to hide. But experiment. I think that's the whole point, is just experiment and make Lightroom kind of suit your own needs. Now, of course, this is just kind of skimming the surface of everything that Lightroom has to offer in desktop and mobile and web. If you want to learn everything there is to know about Lightroom, please do check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. I'll leave a link to it in the description below. And I mentioned that I have this video that kind of goes through some other kind of ways to use Lightroom, so check that out. If you found this video helpful, a thumbs up is greatly appreciated. It does help the channel. And please click on subscribe and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.